scripture passages for today are entirely fitting, I think, for this contentious time in our country. Psalm 23 is the plea on my own heart and that I hear from many lips. God, we are striving to be righteous and to do the right thing. We are trying to rise above to keep ourselves from getting bogged down in partisan fights, steeped in long-time grievances and fears. But we need help. How long? How long, O Lord? How long, O Lord, will the wicked triumph? How long will this mess continue? The author of the book of Hebrews reminds us not only that God has always been with us, but also that God is active on our behalf to the utmost extent. So much so that God does not allow us to get what we deserve in our sinfulness, but has sent Jesus to make us and all things new. The problem is, the challenge is, that we have to want to be made new. We talk about God being a God of power and might, but the way in which God is powerful is completely opposite that of the way that fallen, sinful human beings usually go about being powerful. In the kingdom of this world, we go about being powerful how? By force, by verbally compelling, by physically or emotionally coercing, by threat of violence, or by violence itself. The way in which God is powerful is perfectly captured in a prayer that we offer for the church. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light. It's one of my favorites. You probably know it. Look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. God exercises God's power in love and goodness, in mercy and mystery, in turning the things of this world on their head to bring them back around to the perfection they were given in their being at the time of their creation. Do you remember when we say that prayer? We say it during times of change and transition. We say it at ordinations. We say it at celebrations of new ministry. We say it at parish annual meetings. We say it in the thin places where we come together and dare to ask God to make all things new. Today's gospel lesson brings a word about how God's newness comes. We find this story in the 10th chapter of Mark. At the time these events happen, Jesus has been teaching his disciples, healing, casting out demons, and telling parables for almost 3 years. Jesus and his disciples are on their way to Jerusalem. Some Pharisees come, as they often do, to test Jesus. And they do so in their typical way. Control the narrative. Defend their own power and position. They ask, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? A man. Some man. The question is about the law, notice, not really about the people involved. Jesus responds, what did Moses command you? Jesus does not ask them what they know about the law. Jesus asks them about the call Moses' command puts on their lives. He makes it personal. The Pharisees, intentionally or unintentionally, completely miss Jesus' point. They return to talking about what the law of Moses allows the man to do. Again, Jesus turns it right back on them, pointing out that God's design for relationships was perfect, powerful, beautiful. The laws that the Pharisees are so concerned about just try to contain the messes created when we don't come together with God's idea of who it is that we are called to be. Jesus says to them, they have these laws because of their hardness of heart. My friends, here is what we so often forget. God can only make us new if and when we turn things over to God. When we come to the point where we recognize that we don't have all the answers, that we can't make it on our own. But God knows better than we do. Lately, we have watched many in our country try to improve things by doing exactly the opposite of trusting, of loving. By grabbing what they can get, by fearing and hating others, by defending their territory, by controlling the narrative, by using their might to determine what's the question for us today, though, is not about them. The question for us today is, where is your heart? Where is my heart hard? In the midst of the political fray these days, in the midst of family strife, in the midst of other injustices you or people you love might be facing, what has hardened your heart? What has made you feel justified in grabbing what you can get, in fearing others, in defending your territory, in using whatever you might have to leverage a win for your side? How would things be different if you responded not from a heart-hardened position, but from the position of standing on level ground, as we heard the psalmist say, from the position of knowing that God is present and active, and God is bringing all things to their perfection in Christ. I don't know about you, but looking at things from this perspective makes me aware of how much time I've spent lately being angry and discouraged and disgusted. Looking at things from this perspective makes me want to stop cursing the darkness and start heralding the light. I know that I still need to be active in seeking justice, but looking at things from this perspective makes me want to go about activism in a less self-righteous and vengeful way. Even if someone has done terrible things, even if a group of people have done terrible things, if we believe that the God of unchangeable power and eternal light is even now in the process of putting things right, then we are free to treat others with respect and even kindness that we don't think they might deserve. We are free to lend our hearts and hands and voices to join God in God's work of raising up and making new. There is a way for us to keep our hearts soft and nimble, ready for this work of newness. We can invest in getting back to basics in our own spiritual lives. In the Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis, Screwtape tells his little devil trainee, Wormwood, that Wormwood doesn't have to get the human he's supposed to be harassing to be bad. He just needs to distract the human from being good, to keep the human away, distressed. Well, I think our Lewisian devils are working overtime these days. U.S. politics alone is providing more than enough distraction to keep us spinning endlessly. What stops the spin and grounds us is participation in faithful devotion day by day, week by week, month by month. I love it when those people who do surveys come up with what we already know. An Episcopalian priest and researcher by the name of Jay Sidebotham. Have you seen those cartoons in the Church Pension Fund calendar? He writes those too. He's been doing some research lately, and he has surveyed over 12,000 Episcopalians. And the question he has put to them is, what seeds your spiritual growth? And the answers are what you may expect: Scripture, the Eucharist, prayer, and the example and guidance of faithful leadership. Those four things: Scripture, the Eucharist, prayer, and the example and guidance of faithful leadership. Your faithfulness in these areas is the ground of being, the source of your connection with the loving, liberating, life-giving God. We hear so often that God's time is not our time. I don't buy it. I think that God would be delighted for justice to roll down like mighty waters right now. Are we willing to align our goals with God's goals? Are we willing to align our methods with God's methods as God carries out in tranquility the plan of salvation for all? Today, this week, this month, this year, may we see God's kingdom come on earth, and may it begin today.